Professor Dave here. I want to tell you about line integrals.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
By now, we are very familiar with ordinary integrals. Integrating f of x dx lets us find the area under a curve given by the function f of x. Integrating f of x y dx dy lets us find the volume under a surface given by the function f of x y. Now, with line integrals, we can integrate a surface, f of x, y, along the path of some curve C. We will be integrating along small segments of the curve C, which we will call ds. Just like when we initially learned integration, these segments will be our widths, while the surface, f of x, y, will be our heights. So once again, our integration will give an area, but now we are finding the area under a surface along a particular path within that surface. The way we will write this out is the integration along C of f of x, y, ds. Recall that when we learned how to evaluate multiple integrals, the x and y variables were treated independently during the integration. But now with line integrals, we have a single integral with both x and y. We must keep in mind that the curve we are integrating along constrains the relationship between the two variables. Because of this, we can no longer treat them independently, but this also opens up the possibility of reducing things to a single variable that is to be integrated. In order to calculate line integrals by hand, it is often necessary to be able to express the curve C as two separate equations, one for x and one for y, that both depend on a new variable, t. As we have learned in a previous tutorial, x of t and y of t are referred to as parametric equations, and as t varies, the x and y coordinates of the curve they form will be mapped out. For a quick example, consider the equations x of t equals t over 2 and y of t equals t squared. We can easily see the curve this would map out by solving for t in terms of x and substituting it into the equation for y. By multiplying the first equation by 2, we see that t equals 2x, which when plugged into the second equation gives us y equals 2x quantity squared, or just 4x squared. We can easily plot this equation. Now let's say t runs from 0 to 6. We could plug these values into our parametric equations to get the starting and ending points on this curve for these values of t. For t equals 0, we get x equals 0 and y equals 0. For t equals 6, we get x equals 3 and y equals 36. For this range of t, we are left with this part of the curve between these two points. Now, why are parametric equations so useful for line integrals? With parametric equations, we can write out the ds term in the integral as something we can actually calculate by hand. So ds ends up being equal to root dx dt squared plus dy dt squared dt. This represents the infinitesimal space between two points along the curve C, with an incremental change to the parametric variable t. Now that we know this, and our integration is in terms of t, we can now express our line integral as the integral from A to B of f of x, y, root dx dt squared, plus dy dt squared dt. So given a surface f of x, y, and a curve C, we must take the derivatives of the parametric equations with respect to t and plug everything into this equation. Then we integrate from the lower bound of t, which is A, to the upper bound of t, which is B. As an example, consider the surface given by f of x, y equals 2x, and our curve C being the same as the one we discussed earlier with parametric equations, x of t equals t over 2, and y of t equals t squared, letting t run from 0 to 6. we can go ahead and plug all of this information into our equation for line integrals. But notice that f of x, y is still in terms of x, whereas we want to integrate with respect to t. We must replace the x with the appropriate expression in terms of t. Luckily, the parametric equation x of t gives us just that, so we can replace x with t over 2. Now we must get the terms dx dt and dy dt, which will just be the derivatives of the parametric equations. Differentiating x of t equals t over 2, we get dx dt equals 1/2. And for y of t equals t squared, we get dy dt equals 2t. Plugging everything in, our line integral becomes the integral from 0 to 6 of t, root 1/2 squared plus 2t quantity squared dt, which simplifies to the integral of t root 1/4 plus 4t squared dt. To solve this, we must use substitution, letting u equal 1/4 plus 4t squared, which, when we differentiate both sides, gives du equals 8t dt. We have t dt in the expression, so let's change that to du over 8. And now we can write the line integral strictly in terms of u, which gives us 1/8 times the integral of root u du. This is simple to integrate if we think of the root as an exponent equal to 1/2. We will get 1/8 times 2/3 u to the 3/2, evaluated from the lower bound of 0 to the upper bound of 6. Simplifying and plugging our original expression back in, we have 1/12 times 1/4 plus 4t squared to the 3/2 from 0 to 6. Plugging in t equals 6 and subtracting from that the expression at t equals 0, we get 1/12 times 1/4 plus 4 times 36 to the 3/2 minus 1/12 times 1/4 to the 3/2. Plugging this into a calculator gives us approximately 144.36. This is the area under the surface f of xy equals 2x along our curve C. We have now gone over the basic approach for line integrals, but like many concepts in math, their applications and complexity can vary. A useful property for more complex cases is the ability to split a curve up into separate pieces for integration. Given a curve like this, for example, you could consider each part of it as separate curves, and the whole line integral can be expressed as the sum of each. It's also possible to consider line integrals with respect to x and y only. These are much simpler calculations, as the ds is simply replaced with dx or dy, respectively. And if we want to put these in parametric form, we get the integral from a to b of f dx dt dt for x, and the integral from a to b of f dy dt dt for y. One more thing to note is that line integrals are not limited to just the dimensions we have been using here. If we wanted a line integral of a function f of x, y, z, we would need to use a higher dimensional ds, which ends up being root dx dt squared plus dy dt squared plus dz dt squared dt. Additionally, line integrals become very useful with vector fields. Recall that vector fields have the form f equals pxyz, qxyz, rxyz. The line integral of this vector field along some curve C is given by the integral along C of f dot dr, where dr is the vector dx, dy, dz. Going through the dot product, we can see that the line integral can be expressed as the integral over C of p dx plus q dy plus r dz. If our curve is parameterized by t, the dx can be replaced with dx dt dt. the dy by dy dt dt, and the dz by dz dt dt. What this line integration calculates with vector fields can be thought of as how much of the vector field is in the direction of the curve. This makes sense as we are dotting the vector field, which takes the tangential component of the field to the path of the curve. In physics, this calculation can be used to find the work done by a force along a path. An important thing to note about line integrals is that in most cases, the path taken affects the answer. That is, even with the same starting and ending points, A and B, the line integral over different paths can yield different answers. There is an exception that will cause line integrals to be independent of paths, and this is when the vector field F is conservative. Remember, this means that the vector field can be written as the gradient of some function f. This is because the line integrals of gradient vectors have a special property to them. The integral over a curve C of the gradient of f dot dr equals the function f evaluated at the endpoint B minus f evaluated at the starting point A. This expression is what is known as the fundamental theorem for line integrals. Line integrals can be a bit confusing due to the notation and having to take the curves into account for calculations, but we have outlined a range of uses, and this will be important in understanding a theorem which we will be discussing soon. Let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.